the Mario and Luigi games are some of my favorite Mario games produced by Nintendo. And to celebrate the Mario and Luigi RPG series turning 20, I'm going to be covering the Mario and Luigi Iceberg, created by ParticularProduct55 on Reddit. So, for those of you who don't know, an iceberg chart is where topics listed towards the top are generally well known, while entries under the surface level become increasingly more obscure the farther you dive down. Also, for each entry, I will have a text on the bottom right to represent how confident I am about what I'm talking about for that given entry. So, for example, miss means I'm not very confident about it, while okay, good, and great are where I'm somewhat confident. And excellent means I'm completely confident in what I'm talking about. So, if you've played the games, I'm sure you get the way I'm representing my confidence. Regardless, I'll do my best to cover each one as thoroughly as I can. And with that, let's jump right into it. Broken pipes inside Bowser. The broken pipes inside Bowser referred to the area in Bowser's Inside Story called the Pipe Yard. There are many different pipes in this area that connect to locations all throughout the Mushroom Kingdom, such as Dimblewood, the Toadtown Caves, and Bowser's Castle. In parts of the game, the player needs to head to the pipe yard to leave Bowser's body. The broken red pipe falls only after Bowser gets electrocuted, letting you access the outside. Geno. Geno, who first appeared in Super Mario RPG, makes a brief cameo appearance during the Star Stash minigame in Little Fungi Town. Sadly, though, he does not make an appearance in the remake.
Forget about controlling my anger! Let's ride!
Shrooms frozen in Bowser's Castle. In Bowser's Castle and Bowser's Inside Story, there is a secret hidden room underneath the castle where Bowser has stored the remnants of shrooms from the prequel, Mario and Luigi Partners in Time. In the game, accessing this room allows the player to battle an optional boss with three shroom enemies. Sharkbone. So, this entry is referring to the Sharkbone enemy found in Superstar Saga. Gorhar Lagoon is home to thin enemies named ... that could be one of two forms. A shark skeleton or a cheap-cheap-like fish. Though the enemy has only one name, Nintendo Power's official player's guide lists different names for both forms. Sharkbone, which fits ... bony variation, and Puffer Cheep, which is what the Cheep Cheeps in Oho Ocean change into when they are attacked. It may seem that NP made a horrible mistake, but the text Sharkbone does exist inside the ROM with the other Gorhar Lagoon enemy names. Therefore, the NP guide editors probably had an early version where the ... enemy had two different names. In the German text, though, Sharkbone is Sand Cheep. In August of 2012, YouTube user Charlie's Dr. Pepper uploaded a video testing out the ... scripts on Goombas. The script shown Luigi being poisoned by a Goomba, which also happens with the Gorhar Lagoon Sharkbone enemies. Fawful and Smash. In Super Smash Bros. 4, Fawful was a highly requested fighter character. He was so popular that modders actually made a way to replace the Koopalings with Fawful. Fawful's Antenna. Fawful's antenna is revealed towards the end of Superstar Saga and at Fawful's badge shop in Partners in Time, but is absent in Bowser's Inside Story. Why is this? And where did the antenna even come from? Destroy. The main threat in Partners in Time, the Shroobs, are a mysterious alien race that invade the Mushroom Kingdom of the past with a motive unknown until revealed before the Princess Shroob battle, when we learn the phrase that they've been uttering throughout the entire game, destroy. It makes sense why this is considered one of, if not the darkest Mario games. Broken motion controls. Mario & Luigi Dream Team was the first game in the series to feature motion controls. These motion controls were featured mainly in Luiginary attacks, as well as giant battles. But some players struggled with these motion controls, and some would get stuck during giant battles due to a glitch where Giant Luigi would be frozen in place, unable to move. Now, Nintendo did release a game patch shortly after the game's North American release date. I'm not sure if this specific bug was addressed or not. Alpha Cretan based on Alpha Dream logo. The Alpha Cretan is a boss you fight at the end of the Flab Zone in Bowser's Inside Story, a molecule-like enemy with two forms called Alpha Cretan and Beta Cretan. Its North American name being a pun on keratin, which is a body protein. Its design is based off the Alpha Dream logo, as well as the name Alpha Dream. However, Alpha Cretan is known for being structurally stable, and when exposed to stress, the surrounding bonds break, creating, you guessed it, Beta Cretan. So, really, the Alpha Dream logo is actually based off of the Alpha Cretan. Pretty cool correlation. Bowser still has the vacuum block. The vacuum block first appeared in Bowser's Inside Story, being how Bowser is able to inhale enemies for the bros to finish off inside him. It is a key item in the game, but after Bowser's Inside Story, Bowser is seen to still have possession of it. Right before the final battle in Dream Team, Bowser inhales the fragments of the Dream Stone, turning him into Dreamy Bowser. This means Bowser still holds the vacuum block, even after the events of Bowser's Inside Story. Bink is Donkey Kong's corpse. Bink is a minor character who appears as an undead skeleton Kong in Superstar Saga during the Barrel minigame. Bink's sprite was changed in the remake to just one of the generic SS Chocola crew members. Whether Bink is an actual undead Kong is not explicitly stated though. However, it was actually recently discovered that early in Superstar Saga's development that Bink was actually alive and not a skeleton. If I had to guess, since Bink throws barrels at the bros in the minigame, it was meant to be a reference to the original Donkey Kong game. But another question is raised, then why is a random Kong just hanging out on a ship inhabited by a bunch of skeletal crew? That would honestly make a lot of sense as to why Bink was changed to also be skeletal, so that the Donkey Kong reference would be kept while keeping the undead crew theme intact. There you go, mystery solved! How did Birdo get her voice back? An unanswered question in Superstar Saga is how did Birdo get her voice back before the bros' fourth encounter with Popple? It was made clear that Peach's voice was never stolen, but instead Birdo's was after disguising herself as Princess Peach. Okay, the simple explanation for this would be that this is not the same Birdo. After all, you fight multiple different Birdos in Super Mario Bros. 2. But since it's not explicitly stated that this is a different Birdo, then how did she get her voice back? So, in the Minion Quest mode, present in the remake, Birdo is waiting in line to audition to be Popple's next rookie, and at this point, is shown to have her voice fully intact. Maybe Birdo traveled to Woohoo University and got it back from one of the Peach bots? This was probably an oversight by the developers. American version of Superstar Saga released before Japanese version. The American and Japanese versions of Superstar Saga, while being released not even 2 weeks apart, are surprisingly different from each other. For example, in the American version, when you fight Fawful before the final boss, it plays Popple's theme by mistake. This was corrected in a Japanese release, and eventually in all versions of the remake. Fawful could have redeemed himself in Partners in Time. In Partners in Time, Fawful makes a cameo appearance. If you head to the castle sewers and have the babies drill into a gated pipe, inside you will meet with Fawful, who won't recognize the babies as the past red and green mustachioed enemies that Fawful has come to hate. This cameo has Fawful, the merchant of an underground bad shop, which you could collect with beans that you find throughout your adventure. Fawful explains his story to the babies and is shown to have some regrets when asking the babies if he had insanity and half evil. However, Fawful was clearly planning to overthrow Cacoletta at the end of Superstar Saga, and later planned to take over the Mushroom Kingdom with bioterrorism. Sure, Fawful could have redeemed himself, but be honest, would you have wanted him to? Wiggler boss fights. In the Mario & Luigi games, Wiggler is a character that you end up battling in every installment. Superstar Saga, Partners in Time, Bowser's Inside Story, Dream Team, and Paper Jam. It was recently discovered, though, that Wiggler was probably gonna just be a regular enemy and not a boss in Superstar Saga's E3 prototype build that was leaked. In Partners in Time, the Wiggler is a shrew variant called the Swiggler, and games afterward give Wiggler dialogue. Dream Team Miiverse Glitch. In 2014, a glitch involving launching Dream Team was discovered to allow anyone on Miiverse to post any image that they desired. This glitch only worked without the update for Dream Team though. With Miiverse being shut down, this glitch is history. Sling Sniper weak points. The Sling Sniper is a bros attack in Dream Team where Luigi is used as the slingshot projectile. To aim, the player must use the 3DS's motion controls, which are incredibly sensitive to user input. This attack is also timing based, as you can aim the crosshair directly at your target, but if you take too long, the slingshot will slowly recoil back to its starting position, weakening the impact. Superstar Saga off-model classic Mario enemies. One noteworthy thing about the original Superstar Saga was that there were unique designs for the enemies you encountered. However, in the remake, they stripped those designs in order to make them look more like the classic Mario games. While this change isn't that big of a deal, it upset many fans of the original. I'll touch on these decisions by Nintendo in a later entry. Shrew Princess is still alive. At the end of Partners in Time, Elder Princess Shrew doesn't die in the final battle, but does merge with Bowser to make Shrouser. The bros and the babies do defeat this version of Bowser and vanquish the Elder Shroom Princess, only for her and her sister to appear frozen in Bowser's castle in Bowser's Inside Story. Like I mentioned in a previous entry, this has led many fans to believe that they would make the return in a sequel. But since Alpha Dream went bankrupt and we stopped getting new Mario & Luigi games in 2019, we may never know for certain if they survived. Toadtown theme inside of Bowser. The Toadtown theme inside Bowser is a song present in Bowser's Inside Story. While you could go through Toadtown as Bowser to access Princess Peach's castle, you have no reason to ever switch to the bros while playing as Bowser while in Toadtown. Same goes for the Blubba Lake underwater theme while playing as Bowser. But since this is a video game, developers have to consider things that players might want to do even if they aren't necessarily required. Have you gone out of your way to hear either of these themes? Let me know in the comments. Let It Blow. In Mario & Luigi Dream Team, during the Smoldergeist boss battle, Starlo gives the bros a tutorial on how to use the badges, and then how to defeat the boss itself. Starlo yells, "Let it blow," which causes a gust of wind from off-screen, which weakens the Smoldergeists. It's never explained how or where this gust of wind even came from. The best explanation I could come up with is that Starlo, being a star spray, has powers which we aren't even aware of. Perhaps it is possible at one point that Starlo was actually telling the player to blow into the 3DS microphone, and that might be where the gust of wind was meant to come from. We can only speculate. Pump Works Drill Bros Room. In Bowser's Inside Story, there's a secret bonus area in the Pump Works that can only be accessed after learning Drill Bros. This is an entirely optional area that many players may overlook or forget about. Husky Hoohooligans Connection. The Huskies are NPCs found in Dream Team that resemble the Hoohooligans from Superstar Saga. The Huskies, Big Massive and Little Massive, play a big role in helping Mario and Luigi with their adventure in climbing up Mount Pajamaja in Dream Team. Hoohooligans mention the Hoohoo civilization, a once great people, that are believed to be their descendants. The Bean Bean Kingdom is frequently mentioned in Dream Team, so it is most likely that there is a connection. Mushroom Kingdom Economy Busted. A common gag played throughout Superstar Saga is that the exchange rate between the Bean Bean Kingdom's currency and the Mushroom Kingdom's is changing constantly. At the start of the game, you'll have roughly 100 Mushroom Kingdom coins that translate to roughly 10 Bean Bean coins. But later in the game, Prince Peasley's 99 trillion Mushroom coins only translates to 99 Bean Bean coins, making it clear that the Mushroom Kingdom would have a busted economy if the bros brought back all those coins that they earned in the Bean Bean Kingdom. But this is a Super Mario game we're talking about. The Mario Bros probably hoard most of the wealth of the Mushroom Kingdom anyway. Superstar Saga is a movie. In Superstar Saga, upon completing the game, it is revealed post-credits that Superstar Saga was actually a movie being watched by Yoshis at the Yoshi Theater, similar to how the events of Super Mario Bros. 2 turned out to be a dream and how Super Mario Bros. 3 was actually a stage play. What is strange is that there's a Mario & Luigi poster during the bros' adventure. So, if this is a movie, then is Lakitu following the bros like in Super Mario 64? Hang on. Is this a reenactment or a documentary? And then there's the remake where the poster is omitted entirely. I have so many questions. Massive bros faking their accent. The Massive Bros are big burly huskies that you encounter in Dream Team. They both speak in an implied Russian accent. When Big Massive is stuck in the Dream World, the Dream Team, get it, go in to look for him to get him to wake up. They find him disguised as a green tour guide who talks without the accent. But when Big Massive reveals his true identity, he says, "Da is me, is Big Massive. Whole time in big disguise is perfect fake accent." Big Massive faked his accent in the Dream World to disguise his identity. But why? It could be that his fake accent is their true accent and that the Russian one is fake, but I highly doubt this. Pelodium Self-Destruction Boo Biscuits. The Pelodium statue is a robotic boss found in Dream Team's Somnum Woods, a defense system for the Pelo Temple. It is quite a strange boss since when it is close to being defeated, it ends up activating a self-destruct timer, and if you don't defeat it in time, it could cause you to game over if you don't have enough HP to tank the explosion. However, couldn't you just pop a couple of Boo Biscuits and avoid the hefty damage altogether? I couldn't find any footage online of this being done anywhere. Japan version of Superstar Saga is easier. The Japanese version of Superstar Saga was released mere days after the American version and made a lot of changes such as a D-pad HUD pop-up for the Toad section, additional BP at the start of the game, a tip from Lakitu that you could press up or down to change any bonus stat, enemy stat changes, and the addition of heart blocks. Speaking of heart blocks, heart blocks. Heart blocks, or recovery blocks, are blocks that fully heal the player's HP and BP. These blocks first appear in Partners in Time, but are pretty scarce, or if you're Japanese, it first appears in the Japanese version of Superstar Saga, which are found in Bing Bing Castle, Tihi Valley, and Oho Oasis. They are absent from the international version, but make a return in all versions of the remake. They are replaced in Bowser's Inside Story with shot blocks that only Bowser can access, and they also appear in Paper Jam. Bowser's Map Color Coding in Bowser's Inside Story. In Bowser's Inside Story, there is a map hub of Bowser's entire body which the bros will navigate throughout the adventure. Some locations are colored differently. For example, there are areas like the Nose Deck, Chest Station, Arm Center, Gut Check, Leg Outpost, and Rump Command colored red, while areas such as the Memory Banks, Nerve Cluster, Funny Bone, etc. are all colored blue. The large areas with many enemies are green, and smaller areas are blue, while minigame areas are red. The challenge node is the only area with a unique color. Oho Gear. The Oho Gear is a drop by the Boomerang Bros only found in the Japanese version of Superstar Saga. However, the Oho Gear can be obtained in the remake with an 11% to 25% chance of being dropped. It gives you a 61 plus increase in defense and 12 plus increase in speed. Pelo Island Climate Zone Inconsistencies. At the heart of Pelo Island is Pelo Castle. It basically is a hotel for tourists to stay at. Throughout your adventure on the island, you visit a grassland, desert, beach, forest, and the icy summit of Pajamaja, all within walking distance of each other. It is quite peculiar as to just how the climate works on this island. And then there's the Dream World, but it's just based off of where you are in the real world. So, what's going on here? Kakaleta's Theme in Deep Castle. At the end of your adventure in Bowser's Inside Story, you hear the amazing Deep Castle track when exploring Fofolified Peach's Castle. A neat leitmotif, a recurrent musical piece present in another place, is you can hear a bit of Kakaleta's Theme from Superstar Saga. Here, take a listen. Fawful Zeekeeper. At the start of Dream Team, there's an NPC that if you talk to them, they say, "I have excitement," having many fans speculating that this is actually Fawful in a Zeekeeper costume. This is likely not Fawful, but rather a fun little Easter egg put in by the developers referencing Fawful. I doubt after the events of Bowser's Inside Story if Fawful even survived, but we can all wish, right? Dreamer and movie poster in the Superstar Saga remake. In the remake of Superstar Saga inside of Yoshi Theater, I mentioned the Mario and Luigi movie poster being omitted. But now instead, we have movie posters that reference characters from prior Mario and Luigi games, like the Shroobs on the left, Monsieur Broke and a Cheep Cheep in the center, and Prince Dreamer on the right. Did they make a movie about him? Does this mean Superstar Saga takes place before or after Dream Team? I still have so many questions. Bowser X glitched in the German release. In the challenge node in Bowser's Inside Story, you can fight harder versions of enemies you have fought previously, including Bowser? Don't worry, we'll get into the idea of Bowser being inside of his own body in a later entry, but basically, in the German release of Bowser's Inside Story, it's possible for the Bowser sprite to become a mess of glitchy graphics. This glitch is exclusive to the European version, and is more common if the language is set to German. Glitches with this fight can still occur in other releases, but the worst thing that will happen is that too many projectiles or inputs can cause the game to crash, which actually happened to me once. Broke Monsieur possessed by Intasima. In Dream Team, something weird happens towards the start of the game, where Broke Monsieur appears to be possessed by Intasima. However, it is revealed it's only an act. But if it was an act, why was there a dark purple Intasima cloud surrounding him? After being revealed to only be an act, it is then never mentioned again. Partners in Time enemy counters. Okay, I gotta be honest, for this entry, I'm not sure what this is referring to. It might be referring to counter-attacking enemies, or maybe how some shroob enemies, like the ones the bros fight at the beginning of the game, have a timer that will nuke them when it reaches zero, but other than that, I have no clue. Smoldergeist's motive. The Smoldergeists are the first boss battle you encounter in Mario & Luigi Dream Team. Beneath Pilo Castle, the Smoldergeists seem to act as guardians of a hidden place. When Mario & Luigi take the treasure below, the Smoldergeists attack. Their motive, though, is ambiguous, but what is stolen? A pillow and two badges? And after beating the four Smoldergeists, the statue is disappointed that it failed. Well, my guess is with the overabundance of tutorials you encounter, and the taunting of never making it past the tutorial, the motive might just be to aggravate the player enough to not want to play anymore. Look, I love Dream Team, but I'm happy Paper Jam made the tutorials optional. Knock Knock Joke Competition. In 2003, Nintendo promoted Superstar Saga by having a Knock Knock Joke contest online, where anyone could submit a Knock Knock Joke for the opportunity to win prizes. They even got celebrity comedian Kathy Griffin to judge the jokes. Eventually, the grand prize winner would win a GameCube, three GameCube games, a Game Boy player, a Game Boy Advance cable, memory card, bag, and a year online comedy writing class. Weird way to promote the game, if you ask me. What happened to Midbus? After Bowser fought Blizzard Midbus in Bowser's Inside Story, he is used so Mario and Luigi can progress through the airway, where they eventually encounter and battle the Dark Star. But what happens to Midbus after the events of Bowser's Inside Story? Perhaps we could glean an idea based on what happened to the Shroobs. As mentioned in previous entries, the Shroobs were frozen and stored deep inside Bowser's castle. However, what if inside Peach's castle, there's room similar? I mean, Princess Peach and Bowser's castles are literally mirroring each other on the title screen. It is even shown that there are freezers inside the castle. What if the Toads are keeping Midbus stored in the castle freezers to thaw him out and eat him later? Or upon restoring the castle after the events of Bowser's Inside Story, a Toad simply found a frozen Midbus and threw him out with the trash. Yeah, this would be really ironic, like if the Toads just said, "Go be trashy in this trash hole with this trash robot forever." Poor Midbus. Pig mask logo on Midbus's shoulder. There's a symbol on Midbus's arm. It's a bit hard to make out on his sprites, but is shown prominently in his official artwork, and it strongly resembles the pig mask symbol found in Mother 3. Whether this is just a coincidence or an Easter egg is unknown. Bowser's Inside Story Final Battle Randomness. Final Battle Randomness is a YouTube video created by Mark Hest with Macromedia Flash. The video contains over 2 million views and is a pretty hilarious parody on the final battle in Bowser's Inside Story. I remember watching this video as a kid and having a good laugh. So, if you haven't seen the video, check it out! Broke Madame works for Bowser in Dream Team. Broke Madame is a side character found in both Bowser's Inside Story and Dream Team, and in Dream Team is the one who suggests to the bros that they should hide Princess Peach in the Dream World. But it turns out that it was Kamek and the elite trio disguised as Princess Peach all along. So that begs the question, does this mean Broke Madame was in on the deception? Well, it is shown that she met Bowser during Bowser's Inside Story, and technically it was Bowser working for her there. But still, perhaps Broke Madame owed Bowser a favor, or maybe Bowser threatened her. Whether it is true or not is unknown. Midbus, the main villain of Mario & Luigi RPG 6. Another theory of what happened in Midbus after the events of Bowser's Inside Story is that Midbus survived and was going to be the main villain of Mario & Luigi RPG 5. The idea is that in Superstar Saga, Fafo was Cacoletta's henchman, then took a break in the sequel Partners in Time, and became the main villain of Bowser's Inside Story. So, with that logic, the sequel Dream Team would take a break and we'd have Midbus be the main villain of the fifth installment. However, we now know that wasn't the case since Paper Jam played it quite safe. But what about Mario & Luigi RPG 6? Well, Nintendo has yet to release another Mario & Luigi game since 2019, and with Alpha Dream's bankruptcy, who knows if they ever will. Partners in Time ending theme. In the subsequent versions of Partners in Time, the game got an additional music track completely absent in the American version. Take a listen. Lumbernook code / Tobert's dream. During Bowser's Inside Story, when you drill into the bone in the Lumbernook to fix Bowser's bad back, the game will make you wait a few minutes before you can progress the stories. Ugh, those poor speedrunners. However, it was discovered that a code exists allowing you to just bypass it. Pressing ABXYLRYXBA will trigger Toadsworth alarm early, skipping the whole ordeal. Why did Luigi dream of Final Antasma? Antasma was trapped inside the Dream World for a very long time, and it isn't likely Luigi even knew of Antasma's identity at this point, since Antasma was referred to as ... during the first battle. Luigi wasn't even the one who fought him off in the dream. It was Mario. Antasma isn't seen again until Luigi sleeps on Prince Dreambird's pillow and opens a portal to the Dream World, where Antasma calls out to Peach and sucks her into the Dream World. Antasma may have latched onto Luigi because of him being able to open the portal, which could explain why Antasma appeared in his first dream. Super Mario Kun. Super Mario Kun is a manga series that began in 1990, which has a few entries dedicated to Partners in Time as well as Bowser's Inside Story. The storylines follow that of the games that are based on, but with variations and twists. Personally, I haven't read them, but one example is now the bros are able to speak, and so can the babies for some reason. It's weird. Mamoshka 1-Up Glove Drop Rate. After the boss fight with Mamoshka on the peak of Mount Pajamaja, there's a 50% chance Mamoshka will drop the 1-Up gloves. For players 100%ing the game, if they happen to save after fighting this boss without getting the drop, this item will forever be unobtainable. Yub Eats Fawful Guys. In Bowser's Inside Story, on the outskirts of Bowser's Castle, you'll encounter Fawful Guys. During one of their attacks, though, they'll get swallowed by a tongue off-screen, and this creature aims an egg at the player. This attack is identical to one of Sunnyside's from Partners in Time, which takes place inside Yub's belly. There's even a roar sound effect that sounds just like Yub, too. This is likely just a fun Easter egg, or Fawful Guy egg, if you want to be literal. Tomato Adventure. Tomato Adventure is an RPG developed by Alpha Dream in 2002, considered to be Superstar Saga's spiritual successor. Superstar Saga takes a ton of influence from this game and even includes two unused tracks from Tomato Adventure. The story takes place in the Ketchup Kingdom, inhabited by children ruled by King Abara. The adventure stars DeMille. One day on Tomato Day, a national holiday in the game, DeMille was watching TV and learned of a machine able to let the children stay as kids forever. but finds out later in his adventure that the machine will end up turning all the children into toys instead. This is probably the most bare and basic description of the story, but you get the point. Superstar Saga Starbeans Cafe cameos. In the Starbeans Cafe in Superstar Saga, there are a total of 7 flavors of bean juice the players can create. The first time you make one of these 7 blends, a cutscene with Professor E. Gadd will play, but originally, it was planned to have a cameo from 6 other characters, including Samus, Wario, Fox McCloud, Link, an Excite Bike Racer, and Captain Olimar. Leftover sprite work, as well as unused text, can be found in the game's files. Farmer Boots are OP. The Farmer Boots is an item drop found in Mario & Luigi Dream Team after fighting the Flaming Entasmaton with a 1% chance of obtaining, making it a pretty rare item. If you manage to get this drop, you're looking at a plus 90 in jump power when equipped, as well as occasional bean drops by enemies, instead of coins. Swarms possessing Chain Chaffles. The Swarm is an enemy that is found both in Superstar Saga and in Bowser's Inside Story. In Bowser's Inside Story, they possess chain chomps to create chain chaffles. This enemy actually foreshadows the final boss in a way, because of the idea of possession slash manipulation being one of the game's main themes. I'll discuss this more in a bit. Eldream Spirit. Eldream is a Pilo who appears in Dream Team. After the bros free Eldream from a nightmare chunk in the Dream World, he helps them access Dreams Deep. While all the other Pilos you free from Nightmare Chunks appear as only a head in their spirit forms, Eldream Spirit is the only Pilo in the game who appeared with his entire body intact. Fawful and the Shroobs in Mario 4, A Space Odyssey bootleg. Mario 4, A Space Odyssey is a weird Russian bootleg for the Mega Drive. It uses sprites directly ripped from games like New Super Mario Bros., Yoshi's Island, Mario All-Stars, and even Partners in Time, along with Bowser's Inside Story. The final boss for the game has you beat Bug Fawful and the Shroobs are here too. It's just... why does this have to exist? Bedsmith is gay. Bedsmith is a Pilo in Dream Team who ends up building the Ultabed so the bros could meet the Z-Keeper in Dreamy Somnum Woods. For some reason, he comments on how he wants to nap on Prince Dreambert. This is probably just a silly gag, but might be interpreted as him wanting to sleep with Dreambert. Who knows? Massive Bros Fawful Connections. The Massive Bros and Fawful only have one similarity that I can think of off the top of my head, and that's their obsession with beef. Not sure what other connections this could be referring to. Dummy slash healing Bowser from within. There's an unused item in Bowser's Inside Story named Dummy that resembles a life shroom. If used inside of Bowser, it will be thrown into the air, explode, and heal 60 HP to Bowser. This item was probably scratched because only one boss in the entire game could even harm Bowser from inside his own body. Gromba Swap. Grombas are Goomba-like enemies that appear towards the beginning of Dream Team. They are not exactly strong, and I'm not sure what this entry means by swap. Maybe they were intended to be in the Dream World, and the Drombas that usually appear in the Dream World were meant to be their real-world counterpart. But I couldn't find any evidence of this. FWFUL. In Smash Brawl, one of the names that can be generated from pressing the random name button is FWFUL. This isn't the only name reference here, though. Other video game character names can be generated. Can this just be a coincidence? Maybe, but it's probably not. Darkstar Core acting against Fawful's will. The Darkstar Core is the final boss of Bowser's Inside Story. After Bowser fights Fawful, Fawful merges with the Darkstar to create the full Dark Bowser slash Darkstar Core. While Fawful may not be able to control the Darkstar Core, since it may be acting against his will, in the end, Fawful essentially got what he wanted. When the Darkstar Core is inhaled by Bowser in the final fight, Fawful was hell-bent on ending the Mario Bros. Games right there and then. So perhaps the Darkstar Core was acting against his will. Or maybe not. Paper Jam's development restricted by Nintendo. In an interview with the developers, a first draft of the story was going to revolve going back and forth between the real world and the paper world, with many twists to the narrative, but eventually this was scrapped due to the idea of being too complex. It was, however, rewritten several times to be simplified, where interactions between characters were prioritized. The focus was for Paper Mario to be the standout. Nintendo was very restrictive with the Mario IP around this time, and a lot of fans believed that this is why Paper Jam was lacking in the story department. Smash Bros. Ultimate Spirits. In Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, there are a ton of spirits from across a variety of different video games. and the Mario series is no exception. Many spirits from the Mario RPGs even make an appearance. Some characters from the Mario and Luigi series include Paper Mario, Prince Paisley, Fawful, Princess Shroob, Broke Monsieur, Dreamburg, and even the Mario Papercraft from Paper Jam is here. No Luigi Neri Gravity Tutorial. Luigi Neri Gravity is the 7th Luigi Neri work ability seen in the Dream World and Dream Team. It allows Dreamy Luigi to change the direction of gravity in this area. It appears in Driftwood Shore and is the only Luigi Neri ability in the entire game without a tutorial. Hallelujah! Ice Flower, Yoo-Hoo Cannon, Jump Helmet, and Dream Team. According to the game's files, the Ice Flower, Yoo-Hoo Cannon, and Jump Helmet were planned to appear in Dream Team, but were later scrapped. There are leftover Bowser's Inside Story sprites within the game's files, but the sprite work for these three attacks were pretty complete. The Jump Helmet was even going to be used in 3D. Debug Rooms. The Mario & Luigi games all have special rooms that are used for debugging purposes. To access these rooms, you'll need some sort of cheat code for whichever specific game. So, what are these rooms? In Superstar Saga, there are two debug rooms. In the first is unused tiles, along with Popple for some reason, and slopes, while the second room is pretty much the same, but with some tiles removed in place of more objects. It gets weirder with Partners in Time, where there are rooms with no collision, leftover background art, maybe at one point used for the minimap, rooms for testing object interactions, and rooms with portals that take you to a completely white room. There's also a room that looks like a copy of Fiendbean Castle Town. And in Bowser's Inside Story, there are a few debug rooms too, such as a room with an entrance to the Tower of Yik, a room with single color tiles, you get the idea. Why is there a Dark Star Shrine behind Princess Peach's throne? A mysterious question pondering many is, why is there a Dark Star Shrine behind the throne room in Bowser's Inside Story? It is one of the most perplexing areas in the entire game, and it's just there. It is possible it has something to do with the Dark Power or the Dark Star, but it doesn't explain what or if there was something there before it. Probably Fawful just put it there. Using Miracle Cure on the Dark Star. The Miracle Cure is an object used to cure the Blorbs as well as destroy the Dark Star barrier blocking access to Peach's castle. So why not use the Miracle Cure on the Dark Star itself? Well, I'm not sure, but I feel like this was the plan from the start, at least on the bros side of the story. To get inside the castle, you'll need Bowser. And remember, Bowser is in this for himself, and Bowser doesn't even have the Miracle Cure at this point. Sea Pipe. The Sea Pipe is a statue that acts as the first boss of Bowser's Inside Story. The cutscene before the battle is infamous for the Fawfulcopter's text, which you could crop out yourself, boys. Anyway, the Stone Blooper is the only enemy in the entire game which can harm Bowser from inside of his own body. After defeating the boss, the bros can access the pump works to restore Bowser's flame. Dee Bradley Baker voiced Fawful. Dee Bradley Baker is a voice actor who is known for playing various animal characters in television, but he also voices characters like Perry the Platypus, Daffy Duck, and Squilliam. Whether or not Dee Bradley Baker is the voice of Fawful is unknown, and I'm not sure. He isn't credited in any of the games, and this isn't listed under his IMDb. It is possible that he is just uncredited, but the only other person who it could be is Nami Funashima, a Japanese voice actress. Let me know what you think. Entirety of Superstar Saga is a dream. So remember the earlier entry when Superstar Saga was a movie? Well, now it's possible that this is a dream, and this fairy, I don't understand. If it was a dream, then how does Fawful know about the Bros and Partners in Time and Bowser's Inside Story? Just no. Fawful's opinion of Cacoletta after Superstar Saga. In Superstar Saga, Fawful reveals he is beginning to understand that he is the true mastermind behind Cacoletta's schemes. After all, it was he who created Bowletta. And quite frankly, Fawful's opinion of Cacoletta is irrelevant because we know from Bowser's minions in the remake that he was indeed going to betray her. The Mecha Offals, which first appeared in Bowser's Inside Story, actually were behind the scenes in Superstar Saga the entire time, and ended up doing most of the damage to Fiendbean Castletown. Fawful had respect for his master. After Superstar Saga, it changed once Fawful saw himself as superior. Partners in Crime. Partners in Crime refers to a text error on the supporting paper materials that came with the physical release of Partners in Time. If you look at the product registration sheet, it says Mario & Luigi, trademark, Partners in Crime, copyright 2005, Nintendo. Dark Mecha Offals foreshadow Final Boss. Before fighting the remaining bosses in Bowser's Inside Story, an enemy Bowser will encounter is the Dark Mecha Offal. These blue robotic Foffles are pretty similar to the normal Mecha Foffles, but with a distinction. They share similarities with the punching attack used by Dark Bowser, the laser attack is similar to the one used by the Dark Star, and of course the appearance compared to the regular Mecha Foffles. Pretty cool. Partners in Time title screen with only the babies. During the beginning of Partners in Time, there's a specific point where if you save your game on the Koopa Cruiser with just the babies and return to the title screen, the bros will be absent and just the babies will be shown. This is a fun little Easter egg that not many players would see unless you were to save and quit, and even then you might not even notice when booting up the game again. Unused enemy behavior in Bowser's Inside Story. Scavo documents what these unused enemy behaviors are, but essentially there are enemies in Bowser's Inside Story that have either incomplete attacks, or there are enemies that softlock your game if you try to load them in. There are even giant battle enemies that you can load into regular battles, which we'll be tackling in an upcoming entry. Mossy Goomba and Pop Goomba. Pop and Moss are two unused Goomba enemies in Superstar Saga. They behave like normal Goombas, but are mere palette swaps. It is likely these two were used for debugging purposes during the development of Superstar Saga. Goombas are the most basic enemy you fight in Superstar Saga, so that would make sense. Superstar Saga on Game Boy Player. The Game Boy Player is a GameCube accessory that allows you to play Game Boy Advance games on your TV. It functions like the Super Game Boy did, and some GBA games have this on the boot-up screen, such as Superstar Saga, which basically meant it could use the GameCube controller's rumble pack on a GBA game. This is pretty cool, but that's not all. The developers at Alpha Dream added a way for two players to play. So, if a second controller is plugged into the GameCube, Player 2 could control Player 1, meaning you could have Player 1 control Mario exclusively with the A button, and Player 2 control Luigi exclusively with the B button. Dream Spirit after Dreamstone was destroyed. The Dreamstone is an ancient artifact in Dream Team. The Dreamstone also had a spirit, which Mario and Luigi do encounter in the Dream World, who ends up being one of the funniest characters in the entire game. By the end of the game, the Dreamstone ends up being shattered by Starlo and Peach to prevent it from being used by Bowser, only for Bowser to inhale the pieces becoming Dreamy Bowser. So what happened to the Dream Spirit? Okay, I'd be happy to not tell you, I'm just kidding. But since it is never explained, it is unknown what happened to the Dream Spirit. Bowser knows it's Starlo. After the final boss in Bowser's Inside Story, Starlo reveals she was Chippy throughout the whole adventure. Evidence that could suggest that Bowser knew before this is maybe after the Toadly Clinic boss battle with Bowser, he comments how Starlo is just as annoying as that Chippy thing in my gut. However, he seems completely oblivious for the entire game. I'm not sure about this. Bug Foffle resembles Starlo. When Foffle becomes his bug form and merges with the Dark Star, during the final battle, Dark Bowser is shown to be controlled and possessed by it. This is similar to how Starlo and the bros are manipulating Bowser's body from the inside. The final boss is epic, yes, but it is also symbolic. Mario transforming into a key. Mario transforming into a key refers to a found sprite sheet which has Luigi carrying Mario on the overworld as a key shape. It is unknown what this was meant to be used for. Dream Team's bad ending is happier than the actual ending. This entry used to be named Dream Team's normal ending is the neutral ending, and the fountain dream is the true ending. On Mount Pajamaja, there's a mysterious magical fountain where if you choose to drink from it, the bros end up taking a very long nap. It reminds me a lot of the coffee break scene in Earthbound. Here is this cutscene. It plays off that the bros eat so many mushrooms that they grow as big as the island itself, but realize that they can't return to normal and end up game overing on the spot. Well, at least until Dreambert wakes them up. The dream is weirdly described as being euphoric. It doesn't even show this happening in the dream world. You just get some scrolling text describing the experience plastered onto a background of the sky. Beating the actual game gives you raining coins, which only lasts for a few seconds anyway, so maybe finding happiness was the true ending all along. Hysterique. Hysterique is something that Fawful says in the French version of Bowser's Inside Story. More specifically, after fighting the Dark Star Core, Fawful comes out and says he used to work with a hysterical hag, referring to Cacoletta, before one last-ditch effort to dispose of the bros. Fun fact, the title is actually called Mario & Luigi Journey to the Center of Bowser in French. Bowser Gauntlet. The Bowser Gauntlet is an optional challenge area located in the challenge node in Bowser's Inside Story, where you can face harder versions of previously fought bosses, referred to as an X-Form. I mentioned this briefly in a previous entry, but some of the fights include Dermite X, Cretin X, the Junker X, the Dark Star X, and Bowser X. After defeating the 6th class, a 7th is unlocked where you face all the previous 6 in a row, topping off with Bowser X. Antasma's portal color change. The dream portal Antasma spawns before the final Antasma fight changes color after you defeat Antasma in the dream world. This entry, I'm kind of stumped. I don't know why this happens, or if it's intentional, or just a cool effect, but I don't know. Paper Jam Lakitus working for Bowser. In Paper Jam, the Lakitus are a part of a series of locations known as Lakitu Info Centers. They have various minigames, challenges, and Paper Toad missions. So, the Lakitu's role is different in this game, where instead of being an enemy, like in the original Super Mario Bros., they seem to be allies. But, according to an interview with some of the minds behind Paper Jam, they are actually neutral characters, who do leak information about the bros to Bowser. So, while the Lakitus are working for Bowser, it's only because that this is their job. But, you can say that for all of Bowser's minions, so this doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things. Bowser's Inside Story is a 3D game. While playing Bowser's Inside Story, players would assume Bowser's Inside Story runs in a 2D engine since it uses all 2D sprites. But no, did you know that the game actually runs in a 3D engine? YouTuber She Says discusses how by taking the game's camera and manipulating it, you could see how the environments are rendered. I highly recommend She Says' video going more in depth on the topic. Fighting Bowser's Inside Story giant enemies in regular battles. Some giant enemies are functional, be it somewhat, if placed inside of normal battles. This has some weird effects on the game, like Bowser's Castle, which doesn't even do anything. You also have those Shy Guy ships with the normal battle user interface, and that will refer to them as null if you select to attack it. They are really buggy. Now, I wonder what would happen if you placed normal enemies or bosses in giant battles. Bowser entering his own body. Bowser's Inside Story is a strange game. One of the game's biggest mysteries is, of course, Bowser's body. Just how is Bowser's body so expansive? Seriously, it's bigger on the inside, like the TARDIS from Doctor Who. When Bowser inhaled the vacuum shroom, he ends up inhaling several pipes throughout the Mushroom Kingdom that lead to various locations throughout the kingdom. Halfway through the adventure, the bros have an opportunity to leave Bowser's body through the pipe yard, and they even are able to return to it later. So, this leads to a very striking question. Does this mean, if Bowser were to go through one of these pipes, that Bowser could essentially enter his own body? Hackers have been able to see what it would look like, and it's weird. Totally freaking weird. Brogy was never on Pilo Island. Brogy first appeared in Bowser's Inside Story, and made a cameo inside of Luigi's Dream in the opening sequence of Dream Team. However, after Luigi wakes up, Brogy is absent for the rest of the game. What is stranger is that Brogy is visible in the background of a picture taken on the island. So, I guess this means Brogy was on the island? We just never saw him. Why else would he appear in Luigi's Dream had Luigi not seen him? Dream Team's early game created for misleading advertisement. Dream Team's pacing is odd. And to be honest, quite long, which is how many tutorials you'll be going through. The creator of the Iceberg states that this entry refers to how there are a lot of fake-outs in the beginning of the game, such as Broke Monsieur turning evil, or how Brokey and Broke Monsieur appear only to be irrelevant to the plot of the game. They claim some advertisements shown were scenes from the game taken out of context. Prince Peasley trying to kill the Mario Bros. After defeating Cacoletta's soul at the end of Superstar Saga, Prince Peasley rigs an explosive device inside of Bowser's castle to blow the castle out of the sky. He at least is decent enough to let the bros know they have 3 minutes to get the hell out of there, but this seems rather deliberate. The bros are shown to be surprised, and it's not like they formed a plan with him. So does this mean Prince Peasy was purposely trying to kill the Mario Bros? I don't think this is the case. What motive would Peasy have in doing this? He and the bros have been allies throughout the entire adventure, and besides, why would he tell the bros about the explosive if he planned to kill them? Developers have an inflation fetish. This entry is referring to the many themes found within the first three Mario and Luigi games. Some examples are, you have Mario becoming bloated when drinking water in Superstar Saga, you eating you and being freaking enormous in Partners in Time, and of course, the blorb toads in Bowser's Inside Story. And this doesn't even scratch the surface. It's found all over these games, and it makes you wonder if the developers truly did have some sort of fetish with this. Alpha Dream's custom DS prototype. During the development of Partners in Time, Alpha Dream used a DS prototype, which is a hybrid of a GBA, a SNES-like controller, and a Game Boy SP. It actually is really cool because during the development of Partners in Time, the original Nintendo DS did not even exist yet. A quote from Hiroyuki Kubota, director of Partners in Time, states, "We were only told the DS would have two screens and four buttons, so we didn't really know what to do. So one of our employees made this." Blue Brother. To be honest, this entry might be referring to some third Mario brother that is blue. This is only a guess, but it could be referring to the blue Mario referee in Mario Tennis, but this isn't the Mario Tennis iceberg, so moving on. Kamek's death. In Dream Team, after fighting Kamek for the final time in the Dream World, Kamek explodes. Well, he doesn't really explode, he more like poofs or teleports. Before disappearing, he says he must give his remaining magic to Bowser, which I can see as him using his remaining life force, but he appears fine in the ending cutscene with Bowser and the Elite Trio, so I don't know what this entry is talking about. Ratfink. Ratfink is an insult Thoughtful constantly throws at the brothers. It is slang for an undesirable or uncontemptible person. Thoughtful uses it in his speech even when fighting Mario and Luigi on the Koopa Cruiser and in Bowser's Castle. Thoughtful seems to use both the term Ratfink and Thinkrat. Thoughtful's speech has always been weird and grammatically incorrect, but this kind of shines some light on something. Thoughtful isn't an English speaker. That's why his English is so scrambled. Bowser equals Luigi. In Bowser's Inside Story, you could play as both Mario and Luigi as well as Bowser, but according to the game, Bowser's battle ID is set to Luigi's. What does this mean? Well, when Bowser is in battle, since he is the only playable character present, enemies are set to always attack him. But YouTuber Scowo placed Bowser inside a fight that Mario and Luigi would normally only fight. It was discovered that when the enemy goes to attack Luigi and he isn't there, the game thinks that Bowser is Luigi and attacks Bowser in his place, making Bowser equal Luigi. Muscle Lords fought against the Dark Star. The Muscle Lords, also known as the Heroes of Buffness from the Massive Bros, are ancient powerful fighters brought up in Dream Team. When trekking up Mount Pajamaja, there are various statues and monuments dedicated to them, along with little bits of their history. To be honest, I'm not sure where this theory originated from, so if you have an idea, please let me know. Anti-Piracy, Bowser's Inside Story. When Bowser's Inside Story first released, there were about 10 to 20 different piracy checks in place to deter people from playing a pirated copy of the game. It was nothing noteworthy like Earthbound's, though. For example, it checked for how fast it would save to a flash cart, and would look up certain instances such as when starting battles and loading menus. I'm not sure if pirates ever were able to crack the code. I think they were, though. But for the time, it was a pretty solid and structurally sound method to deter the pirators. Thoughtful speaking German in a Dutch localization. And the final entry on this iceberg is once again related to Thoughtful. This refers to a rumor spread on a wiki that the creator of the iceberg explains likely never existed. Bowser's Inside Story was localized in 6 unique languages. The languages it was included English, Spanish, French, German, Italian, and Korean. Nothing related to a Dutch localization is mentioned anywhere. And that's the Mario & Luigi iceberg. I really do hope you enjoyed this video to celebrate the 20th anniversary of this beloved series. I certainly learned a lot about this series when researching each entry for this video. Something about the Mario and Luigi series that this iceberg missed? Feel free to leave a comment. And hey, before you go, did you know I'm working on a Mario and Luigi fan game? That's right, it's called Mario and Luigi The Forgotten Foe, and it's being created with Game Maker Studio. If you're interested, feel free to check out the Discord. Link is in the description. And with that, thank you so much for watching.